See, I think what's happened is at the top of the culture, it's profoundly intellectually bankrupt. There is no plan except to keep peddling stuff, basically until the forests are gone and the oceans polluted. And this is not malevolent. It's not malevolent. It's simply they are clueless. They have run out of steam. And so the answer is to try and keep the game going as long as possible with daytime TV, with casino gambling, with lotteries, with endless distractions, with pop culture fads, with cults of celebrity, with spectacular trials and gory mass murders and endless circuses, while the people at the top are saying, no, sooner or later, the shit is going to hit the fan. Sooner or later, the dam will burst. And they say, well, let's make sure it's later, not sooner, because I've got two kids at the Sorbonne, I'm paying off the Mercedes, and I need to get this taken care of before it all falls apart. So in the absence of any cultural plan imposed from the top, this strange dynamic is happening. This has happened before in cultural history, where some huge enterprise like Christianity or patriarchy or something like that, after running its games for millennia, it just runs out of steam. And often there's nothing to rush in and fill the vacuum, nothing that is consciously engineered to do that. And so then in those situations, an actual creative bifurcation can take place, because what is about to happen is not in the hands of human managers. It lies deeper in the dynamics of the whole system. And we all feel, I think, this sense of excitement and the approach of the unimaginably new. And we don't know whether it's the aliens coming to pull our chestnuts out of the fire, or virtual reality, or a new drug, or a new style of sexual behaving, or star flight. We don't know what it is, but we can feel that it will transcend the categories of our managers, and they and we will then have to make sense of whatever this new reality is. And it terrifies some people, it liberates others. It's the same reality. You know, Stephen Vincent Benet says something about, at the end of John Brown's Body, he says, when the prophets of strange religions bawl out their bizarre despair, do not join them on the mountain. Say only then, it is here. It is here, because it is here. I mean, that was 1927 when he wrote that, and he spoke then of technology as our humble servant, already half a god. And that was in 1927. You can imagine then what that technology is today. Yeah, huh? A manager class. I'd rather talk about a point in history where there's no more commodities. Yes, I don't think there will be a manager class. A manager class, you manage toward ideology. If we could transcend ideology, the way to manage society, I think, would be self-evident. The problem is trying to force it into the service of some kind of ideological vision. And then, of course, it becomes intractable, because no ideological vision we've ever had has been true to our humanness. You know, the Christian version of what human beings are, the Nazi version, the Marxist version, the secular, market-oriented version, these all somehow insult various parts of our humanness. And so when an attempt is made to push us into these things, it doesn't work, and you get instead war, anxiety, and Q forces swamp the social system. I think the managing of society would be fairly simple in the absence of ideology. But we're addicted to ideology because somewhere along the line we've gotten the idea that you can't understand the world without an ideology, when in fact, and ideologies are incredible impediments. No more bosses. Well, I suppose as long as we are disparate entities, there will be hierarchies of control. That seems obvious. But it seems as though we are playing with the idea that we may not be disparate entities, or that we may be only provisionally disparate entities. You know, we are a peculiar creature, somewhat, and we human beings, as a mass phenomenon, we're somewhat like a slime mold. We have a life cycle where part of our life cycle we appear to be completely separate individuals. But apparently in our, if you view our development over the past few centuries, we're entering into some aggregation phase, triggered by pheromones spread through technology. And we are beginning to create some kind of a superorganism. And the fear of some people is that once inside this superorganism, we will be forced into a permanent status as a sublevel of the hierarchy. In other words, you will have to give up your individuality and you will just become a kind of liver cell or brain cell or something in this organism. But I don't think this is the case. I think we have the unique ability to combine these two modes of existence. This is why we have this notion of society and the private reality of the individual. And probably in the domain of society, there will always be forms of, I don't want to say control, but management of the distribution of commodity. But the idea, I think, is to empower this other dimension, to spend as much time as possible in the individual free-swimming, free agent mode. In other words, not to see membership in society as a goal and a value to be conserved, but to see it as a necessary evil. You know, we need social organization, but in minimal doses. And when we go on a bender of addiction to social normative behaviors, then you get a psychic epidemic like National Socialism, where people voluntarily abandon their individuality to act in concert with some kind of mass impulse. This is extremely evolutionarily retrograde. It's not what we want to do. So I guess what I'm pleading for is an enlightened form of alienation, and not simply an emotionally driven alienation, but a strategically driven alienation. See, alienation can be used not to create neurosis, but to attain freedom. Creative alienation. Alienation that embraces itself as the source of inspiration. Nobody ever said it was going to be comfortable to be a human being and to ride one of these bipedal bodies from the cradle to the grave. I mean, it's an uncomfortable, but I maintain manageable situation. But you have to have the lights on. You have to have your emotional responses in order, your intellectual responses in order. You have to have garnered some sense of how we got to this situation, and you have to have some sense of the tools available to transform it.